I really want to thank, first of all, I want to thank Carmelli and Don Thorson for asking me to give a talk for the Faith Matters. And when they did, I said, okay, but it's got to be on marriage because that's the stuff I've been working on. So they graciously agreed for me to give this talk. And I want to thank you all for coming. So let me, and I am going to read the paper a little bit. I mean, I'll try to be engaging, just because otherwise, as you can already tell, I tend to wander off on a lot of rabbit trails. So with that, let's get started. So the main question that I'm interested in is, what is marriage good for? And for the really old people, you should hear the kind of war. What is it good for? And I wanted to put it that way, but Don thought that was too. So the main question is, what is marriage good for? And more specifically then, too, what is marriage good for? And in asking about the good of marriage, I'm really asking about several things. So the first is, what is the nature, purpose, telos, or what we call the ultimate aim of marriage? So that's number one. Number two, why do people desire or care about it? And I want to say, people may desire or care about something even if they don't intend to participate or partake of it themselves. In other words, I believe that people who never intend to marry can reasonably care about it, desire it, in the sense that they want it to exist, they want political and ecclesial support for it, in order to preserve it or regulate it. So for the philosophers in the room, this means that I'm committing myself to the idea that people can actually have disinterested desires. Not all of our desires have to tap back into our own self-interest. And finally, number three, should people desire or care about marriage? And if so, why? Now, these three questions are obviously related to one another, but they're conceptually distinct. For example, I can think of plenty of activities, the natures and purpose of which could be real known, and nobody really cares about them or wants to participate in them. Conversely, lots of us do seem to care about marriage, and even may desire it for ourselves. And yet we'd be hard-pressed to clearly and precisely explain what it's all about. In fact, I suspect that one of the reasons marriage sometimes disappoints, and it does sometimes disappoint, is because we enter into it with very confused ideas about what purposes it is best suited to serve. Furthermore, just because people do desire or care about something doesn't imply that they should. There's lots of things I desire that I wish I didn't, and that other people probably think I shouldn't. Now, of course, I think we can probably all agree that marriage is something that we ought to care about at least one way or another. That said, I think we can still call into question the weight of this desire and how high marriage weighs on our societal and ecclesial concerns. I've heard several Christians that are committed to lifelong singleness and celibacy argue that the huge emphasis on marriage and the nuclear family unit within their churches and many churches makes it very difficult for them to be viewed as crucial contributing members to the body of Christ. So let's not forget that the married life is just one way to live out our lives before God. And as St. Paul suggested and Christ exemplified, it may not even be the best or the highest way. Okay, so these are my questions, and I have three motivations for asking them. Number one, I am a member of the United Methodist Church, and like many Christian denominations, we are currently embroiled in a debate over whether to bless and sanction same-sex unions. In 1988, over 25 years ago, the UMC General Conference commissioned a committee to study homosexuality. 12 years later, theologian Stanley Hauerwas published a piece explaining why he resigned from this committee. And here's what he said. Okay, so the United Methodist Church, as well as most mainstream Protestant churches in the United States, does not know how to think about homosexuality because it doesn't know how to think about marriage and divorce. Do they think that a marriage is no longer a marriage because the people no longer love each other? Do they think that people who have been divorced can remarry after they've found someone else to love? How should people be examined to discern if they are capable of making the promises we still ask people to make when the church witnesses their marriage? Should people who have been divorced bear a greater burden of proof if they wish to remarry? So according to Hauerwas, churches have tended to underwrite a romantic conception of marriage. You fall in love, and then you get married so that you can have sex to express your love. And he argues, though, that before we can have a constructive dialogue about countenancing same-sex marriages in our church, we need to have a clear collective understanding of what Christian marriage is and what it entails. I agree with him. Therefore, I'm seeing these debates over same-sex marriage as an opportunity to step back and engage in thoughtful, prayerful reflection on the history and future of marriage within our Christian traditions and outside of them. So that's my first motivation. My second motivation stems from my research on the biomedical treatment of intersex children. Intersex, the terms intersex, or what's sometimes called disorders of sexual development, are general terms that refer to variations in the biological markers of sexual identity, chromosomes, gonads, hormones, or the anatomical structure, such that these markers don't line up in a strict male or female classification. In other words, these are children whose bodies do not conform to the standard male or female type. Now, if you're interested in learning more about intersex conditions and the lives of intersex people, then a really good place to start, and I guess I can walk away, is the Interface Project. This is a web-based project that is dedicated to collecting and disseminating videoed first-person narratives of intersex people, and I highly recommend it. The reported incident figures of intersex births vary depending on the conditions classified as intersexed. But in a 2011, the Journal of Advanced Nursing reported that the global incidence rate ranges somewhere between 1.7% and 4%. The World Health Organization currently estimates that 5 children born in the United States each day are visibly intersex. Now, when I read that statistic, I was like, that seems crazy. I can't imagine that's right, and I haven't told her I was gonna use her name, but a biological colleague of mine does research on herpes, and when she got the statistics, she thought, that can't be right, but I guess when she's on the plane and people say, what do, and she tells them, then they go, yeah, I've got herpes, so maybe these rates are a lot higher than we know, but I was stunned by this. And this is noteworthy. Since not all intersex conditions are actually detected at birth, for example, people with complete androgen insensitivity, when they're born, appear to be typically baby girls. It just so happens that they're XY, genetically male. And yeah, this is the kind of thing you often hear about these cases in the news, because what will happen is this happens in sporting events. In the Olympics, there was a case a while ago where women, so if you're complete androgen insensitive, like I said, phenotypically you look female, but you won't menstruate. Now, if you're an athlete, my sister did triathlons. She didn't menstruate for a while. So what happens, though, then, is that for the Olympics, female athletes have to be genetically tested. And what they found out was that there was a certain incident rate of they were XY. So this is just one of a number of intersex conditions. Okay, so given a frequency of intersex birth, it's safe to assume, right, that some of our church membership roles include intersex people. Another question then is whether these folks can marry. And notice that the way that the debate is currently couched, this question really is never addressed. For whether it is opposite sex or same sex marriage, the assumption is that the prospective spouses are one sex or the other. However, this assumption doesn't hold for 5 kids born in the US each day, if we can believe the World Health Organization. Now, parents of visibly intersexed infants are often asked if they want their child to undergo surgery that's aimed and strictly at trying to make them conform as much as possible to a standard type. In making this decision, and most of this information comes from medical journals, nursing journals, of qualitative studies, or interviewing parents that are making this decision, and often they cite the pressure, as you can imagine, they feel to ensure that their child will not be stigmatized or marginalized. Now, suppose some of these parents want to ensure that their child can participate in a Christian marriage. Is this a defensible reason for having children undergo such surgeries? Should parents or should pastors? Should pastors encourage parents to do so? My own inclination is to say no. However, to fully explore the implications of this inclination and to justify it, I first need to think a whole heck of a lot more about the nature of Christian marriage. So third and finally, my motivation. Once I began this research, so that's what got me started was the two, but once I actually got into this research, I just started to realize how invested in it I really was, for really strictly personal reasons. I've been married 35 years, and I'm also a part of a huge extended family, most of whom actually live here in Glendora. My dad died 2 years ago, soon after my parents celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary. I have four sons, one of whom is divorced and raising my 7-year-old granddaughter as a single dad. The other is happily married. I just returned from the Bay Area, where he and his wife are wonderfully raising my 6-week-old grandson. In other words, I've experienced and witnessed lots of marriages. And quite frankly, my views on the institution have changed. At 20, when I got married, I believed marriage was primarily about two people and a promise to love and live happily ever after. I now believe it is much more and perhaps less than that. When I look at the marriages that I consider exemplars of marital faithfulness, it is not because the spouses exhibited constant love for one another, at least not in the romantic or erotic sense. And they certainly could not keep each other happy, even when they tried. Rather, they practice what my colleague Dennis Ockham tells us and has written about, that is a Benedictine monk habit. And what is it? Just staying put. I have thus come to appreciate more fully the importance of marriage as the enactment of a vow or covenant, and not just one between two people, but rather between them and all those who witness or will witness their marriage. So for this reason, too, I've become especially interested in St. Augustine's account of marriage as a sacramental signifier of Christian faithfulness. Okay, now other than that last sentence, although I don't know if I stay true to this promise, my plan for tonight is not to assert or defend any theses regarding marriage per se. We could talk about that in the Q&A if you'd like. But one of the problems, I think, in having productive discussions about marriage is that we are all too quick to assert and defend our views before having listened to some significant voices on the matter. And so for tonight, I've picked two. The first is Justice Anthony Kennedy. Kennedy, as you probably all know, is the author of a majority decision in the Obergefell, and I had to read that and figure out, Obergefell versus Hodges. This is the 2015 Supreme Court decision which held that states must license and recognize marriages between two people of the same sex. And the second voice is Augustine. So St. Augustine, and in 401, Augustine penned a short treatise entitled The Good of Marriage. Commentators describe this work as the most complete patristic consideration of the duties of married persons. It is thus a formational text for the theology of Western Christian marriage. And the aim of the treatise now is to show that marital state is a good one, just not as high a good as the continent life of the unmarried. By arguing that the single state is a higher good, Augustine is intending to refute Jehovenian. Jehovenian was a 4th century monk who claimed that the life of the devout nun and faithful wife were no different in the eyes of God. This is not okay for Augustine. So by arguing, he doesn't want to go there. I mean, Augustine wants to hold that the life of a devout nun is higher in God's eyes than that of a faithful wife. But by arguing that marriage is a good and not merely a lesser evil, Augustine also intends to correct on St. Jerome's earlier response to this controversy, which seemed to so denigrate the marital state that he thought it played into the hands of the Manichaeans. Now, I mean, some of that detail you don't need to know, but the idea here is that this work is written to sort of carve a middle position. So my plan for tonight really is just to put Kennedy and Augustine in conversation with one another in an effort to see how they might answer the questions that are on the table. So I'm going to start then, and this is where now you can take out your handout. I'm going to start by reconstructing what I take to be the main, this is what philosophers do, we reconstruct arguments. So I'm reconstructing what I take to be the main premises of Kennedy's primary legal arguments. And since I like to see, when I look at an argument, I like to see all the premises and conclusions on one page. So I printed, I've got them up here, but I've also got a handout for you. Okay. So premise number one, the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment reads that no state shall deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Premise number two, legal precedent has extended these rights, or sorry, these liberties, to certain personal choices central to individual dignity and autonomy, including intimate choices that define personal identity and beliefs. Premise number three, the court has repeatedly held the right to marry is a fundamental right under the Due Process Clause. Now, I'm not a legal scholar, but I'll want to say just to call something a fundamental right has huge significance, because if it's a, so people, some people are going, so they know. So to call something a fundamental right means that if you want to pass legislation that restricts it in any way, it has to pass what's called the strict scrutiny test. And what this means is that the burden of proof is on the state to show that there's, quote, a compelling interest being pursued in this legislation, and that this is the least restrictive means of doing this. The strict scrutiny test is, you know, in theory possible to pass, but very unlikely. And so essentially, if by proving that marriage is a fundamental right under due process, means that you can push very few restrictions on it. Now, as Kennedy acknowledges, all of this legal precedent implicitly and in some cases explicitly defines marriage as opposite sex marriage. So the next premise in his argument is crucial, and it's this. Analyzing the reasons why the court recognizes marriage as a fundamental right demonstrates that they apply with equal force to same-sex couples. So here's what he's trying to, what he's going to do. He's going to say, look, even though these court cases, you know, assume that what they're talking is marriage between a man and a woman, when you look at the reasons why they have granted marriage to be a fundamental right, you're going to see that the reasons that they've given equally apply to same-sex couples. So this really is the crucial thesis. And so what is his support for it? So the first claim is that when you look at these cases, what you see is that marital choice is inherent in the concept of individual autonomy, a choice that shapes someone's destiny and a momentous act of self-definition. Number two. He says, marriage is a two-person union, unlike any other, actualizing the hope of companionship and understanding and assurance that while both still live, there will be someone to care for them. Number three, marriage is a means of safeguarding children and families, providing the requisite recognition, stability, and predictability. Finally, marital unions are a keystone of social order and subject to numerous governmental rights, benefits, and responsibilities. Now, if he can establish all of this, and if you hold all of the things that he said to be true, and if you hold all, and you hold, and he can argue that these same reasons hold in the case of same-sex couples, then he gets his conclusion, and that's what he does. So he concludes, therefore, the court's rationale for holding the right to marry as a fundamental right under the Due Process Clause equally applies to same-sex couples. And he has a couple other arguments, but I take this really to be his main one. Now, Kennedy prefaces this argument with a look at the history of marriage and recounting the stories of the petitioners. Now, when I read through this, I wasn't entirely clear how this history, or how Kennedy thinks that this history and the narratives are to function as sort of premises in his overall argument. But I at least thought, you know, wanted to tease out some of the claims that I took to be so, you know, kind of significant, especially if we're kind of thinking through these things. And the first one is this, that the legitimate method for identifying fundamental rights is one that respects our history and learns from it without allowing the past alone to rule the present. And this was one of the methods that he used, and in the dissents, this is the methodology that came under criticism, because the dissenters felt like the history should have placed much more of a constraint on the ruling than they saw being enacted in the majority decision. Number two, changed understandings of marriage are characteristic of a nation where new dimensions of freedom become apparent to new generations, often through perspectives that begin in pleas of protest and then are considered in the political sphere and the judicial process. And here's what he's saying here, is he says, look, it's been true in our history that we've started to realize that we've treated some people unequally and unfairly. And he's thinking here, you know, about race and race. And so what he argues is when that starts to happen, people bring these pleas, and they bring protests, and they ask to be recognized equally. And then that finds its way into the legislation and judiciary. And then when that happens, we change our understanding of marriage. And he's specifically thinking of laws that we had on the books that barred interracial marriage. So this is, and he has some other examples too. So this is what he's arguing. And then it kind of follows then for him that the history of marriage is one of both continuity and change. Now, because I'm not a lawyer or a constitutional legal scholar, I cannot say whether the majority decision qualifies as a responsible act of jurisprudence. Or, as dissenting justices Roberts, Scalia, Thomas, and Alito all argued, it represents rather an egregious form of judicial activism. I will say you should all read it. And you should read all the dissents. They're a fascinating read. It's not that long. I read it when I was taking care of my grandbaby. They're really accessible, and they're just fascinating. And there's really good points on both sides. In fact, one of the points that that Roberts brings up that I think it's worth mentioning is he argued that you had a discussion about same-sex marriage happening, and people's minds were being changed. And it was making it, and I can't remember, one of the judges, this was democracy at its best. People arguing and making their cases known, convincing one another, and that sort of thing. And the argument then was that by having the judiciary step in, that sort of blocks the discussion prior to having really changed people's minds. And I thought that was a decent point. Like I said, I mean, as we all know, though, sometimes it takes judicial actions to get us to change our minds. So, but again, I just say it really is a fascinating, really fascinating and well deserves attention, and you should read it. Okay, but for our purposes, Kennedy's argument is just a gold mine, since it provides plenty of material for inferring his views on the good of civil marriage. Now, as a side note, I should mention that he explicitly restricts his analysis and findings to marriages that are intended to be recognized by U.S. civil authorities and not religious ones. So it's a little unfair for me, in some sense, to sort of pit, you know, look to what he has to say and think about that in terms of Christian marriage, because he's explicit about that. But it's still, I think it does help, and I think some of he says matches some of our own intuitions about what marriage should be, maybe even in a Christian sense. Okay, so with that as a caveat then, how does Kennedy characterize the nature and purpose of marriage, and how does this compare with Augustine's views? Okay, well look, looking at this first claim, the first thing we need to see is that he considers marriage to be the exercise of a particular right, namely the right of each partner to pursue individual autonomy or self-definition. Now, if we were to turn to Augustine's treatise, The Good of Marriage, we would see no mention of a spouse's individual rights, nor any reference to autonomy. I didn't think he talked about rights at all, but he does. But when Augustine speaks of spousal rights, he means the right that a spouse has over the body of her partner. And this is a contracted right that gives rise to a conjugal debt that both parties are obligated to fulfill on demand. So another sidebar. So when Jeff says no, not allowed. again, as a sidebar, we should note that this seems to imply that for Augustine, the idea of marital rape is incoherent. And maybe this is a good place to say that although I'm really trying to present Augustine and Kennedy's views as clearly and charitably as possible, this does not mean that I endorse, nor that I think you should endorse, everything that they say. And this might be one of them. Okay, so now, it shouldn't surprise us, right, that Augustine and Kennedy's conception of spousal rights differ. When Kennedy speaks of rights and autonomy, he's drawing on the legacy of modern Western political philosophers like John Locke and John Stuart Mill. In Mill's On Liberty, which was published in 1859, autonomy basically means self-definition or expressing one's individuality. Moreover, autonomy in this sense is characterized not merely as a good for humankind, but rather the good, the highest purpose or telos towards which everyone should strive. Now, in fairness to Kennedy, he never suggests that autonomy is the highest good. Still, it is hard to deny the million echoes in this part of his argument. And as I was reading this, I'm saying, this is just Mill. And then when I got to the dissent on justice and Justice Roberts, he goes, we shouldn't be talking about Mill. So okay, I'm right. So therefore, in order to tease out an apparent point of tension, and I say tension because I'm not actually sure it's contradiction, but at least some tension between Kennedy's and Augustine's views on the relative goods of marriage, I'd like us to consider a passage from Mill's On Liberty. So here's what he writes. The end of man, or that which is prescribed by the eternal or immutable dictates of reason and not suggested by vague and transient desires, is the highest and most harmonious development of his powers to a complete and consistent whole. Therefore, the object, the goal, towards which every being must ceaselessly direct his efforts, and on which especially those who design to influence their fellow man must ever keep their eyes, is the individuality of power and development. So for Mill, cultivating and expressing our individuality is the chief end, the ultimate object of any rational desire. Given that Kennedy is invoking a Millian notion of autonomy, then, we can infer that he takes a foremost purpose of marriage to be enabling spouses to develop their unique personalities and their particular ways of being in the world. To the extent that marriage functions, then, as a means toward achieving this highest good, any desire or concern for marriage would be a rational and supportable one. Now let's compare this, then, to what Augustine says about the highest human good. This is not in The Good of Marriage, this is some of his other writings. But why should I argue more about ways of life? For if God is the highest good of human being, something that you cannot deny, he thinks he's argued for this, it certainly follows that to see the highest good is to live well, and that to live well is nothing other than to love God with one's whole heart, one's whole soul, and one's whole mind. Now this Augustinian confession, I think, finds its way into Protestant circles as the first article in the Westminster Catechism. What is the chief end of man? Answer, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. So for Augustine and for those affirming this part of the Catechism, one should desire participation in the married life and be encouraged to pursue this desire if and only if marriage is a sure route to loving, glorifying, and enjoying God forever. Now, many contemporary Christian philosophers and theologians argue that modern notions of autonomy and the value that Enlightenment philosophers attach to it are entirely incompatible with faithful Christian thought and practice. I disagree. In fact, I would argue that autonomy, properly characterized, is something that Christians and even Christian spouses can and should promote. That said, I do think it makes a significant difference in our understanding and practice of marriage if we view it primarily or solely as a means for self-definition and becoming a robust individual, as opposed to a means of experiencing God and expressing one's love for God. Now, when a colleague of mine proofread a draft of this paper, she asked me to say more about how I would reconcile the good of autonomy and the good of loving and enjoying God. Now, providing a complete defensible answer would take us too far afield, but here's the basic idea. First, I would substitute out Mill's notion of autonomy for a Kantian or Hegelian one. Surprise, surprise. When Mill talks about autonomy, he tends to give it a very individualistic cast. Kant and Hegel, yeah. I teach 19th and 20th century, so yeah. And I like Kant and I like Hegel. I like Mill too, but anyways, when he talks about autonomy, he tends to give it a real individualistic cast. In other words, each person, or in this case, each spouse, has a right and responsibility to discover, develop, or pursue her unique interests and capabilities. And the best way we can help each other is simply not to interfere and get out of the way. Furthermore, Mill, and even Kant, I think, draw too strong of a contrast between being self-directed, what they call autonomy, and being other-directed, heteronomy. However, as Hegel points out, there's such a thing as being we-directed. In other words, autonomy is not necessarily incompatible with actually deferring to someone else's judgment. In fact, actualizing your own unique potential may sometimes require that you do just that. Ideally, this is the reason why students defer to a teacher's judgment about what they need to learn. They're trying to maximize their potential, they develop their gifts, but hopefully they understand. Sometimes they know, someone else might know more what they need to learn. So in other words, I don't see any reason why spouses may not mutually defer to one another on various occasions and matters once they've determined that this is the best way of communally pursuing the unique individuals that they were designed to be. Finally then, we need to ask who is better equipped, so now this is getting to the answer, who's better equipped to fully participate in a mutually loving and enjoyable relationship with a person, including one with God. Someone who has never been allowed or never has developed her powers into a unique or harmonious whole, or someone who has? I suggest it's the latter. So this is the way then I would reconcile, you know, the value of autonomy with actually enabling you to participate in an enjoyable, loving relationship with God. All right, so there you go. That's how I did it. Let's pause now then and see how Kennedy and Augustine might answer Howard Wass's question. Remember, the question was this: is marriage still a marriage when love is gone? Based on my interpretations thus far, both Kennedy and Augustine would have to say yes, but for different reasons. So on Kennedy's Millian view, a loveless marriage still serves a marital purpose, so long as spouses are not interfering with each other's quest for individual development and expression. And here I probably need to say a bit more about what Howard Wass or I mean by a loveless marriage. By loveless, I do not mean a marriage where partners loathe or despise one another. Unions of this sort could very well hinder the exercise of a Millian right to autonomy, or even autonomy that I've described. Rather, I believe that Howard Wass is referring to loveless in the sense that the spark which initially held between spouses has died out and may never be rekindled. My point then is that spouses in such a situation could still work on defining themselves, and so the union is still fulfilling a marital purpose as identified by Kennedy. So what about Augustine? What would he say? He too would say yes. insofar as this is, marriage can still function as a means of experiencing and expressing one's love for God. Now, this is implied both in what I said about his seeing marriage as a kind of relative good towards the highest good of loving and enjoying God, okay? But it also follows from what he says about marriage as what he calls a sacramental signifier, and that's what I want to talk about now. So now I'm turning to the good of marriage. In the good of marriage, Augustine lists three goods: offspring, fidelity, and the sacrament. But the sacrament clearly takes precedence over the other two. For Augustine, and this was surprising to me, both the polygamous unions of Hebrew and Israelite patriarchs and the monogamous unions enjoined by the early church are sacramental signs. How so? Here's how. Just as the multiple marriages of that time symbolically signified the future multitude subject to God in all people. So the idea was that these polygamous marriages represented symbolically the idea that one day all people would be united in God. So too, he says, the single marriages in our time, in Christianity, symbolically signify the unity of all of us subject to God, which is to be one in the heavenly city. Now, the monogamy distinctive of Christian marriage, as opposed to the permitted polygamy of ancient Israelite marriage, derives from the fact that Christian marriage symbolizes the perfection of unity, whereby many souls become one city, comprised of one soul and one heart towards God. When treating the second good of fidelity, so when he's talking about fidelity, Augustine really is focusing strictly on sexual fidelity and honoring that spousal obligation that I talked to you about, okay? But when he starts talking about the sacramentum of marriage, then the notion of fidelity's work is much broader and much richer. In this context then, spousal commitment, even when sexual infidelity has occurred, signifies the anticipated faithfulness of God's people and presumably God's faithful union with them. As theologian Lisa Fullman explains, to say that Christian marriage functions as a sacramental signifier is to say that the unshakable connection to one's spouse foreshadows the unity of all humankind with God in the eschaton. This then is how fidelity to a marital covenant serves as a means of experiencing and symbolically representing the highest human good, namely our union with God. Now, I don't know about you, but I used to believe that a loveless marriage constituted a failure to achieve or even to approximate the good of Christian marriage. And since I've witnessed many long-term marriages, including my own, I know that they can indeed be loveless, at least for a season. I've found, however, that the more I observe spousal commitment enacted within those loveless unions and at those loveless times, the more I actually began to see them as best representing a love for God and a love for their spousal neighbor. Having read Augustine, I now have a better understanding as to why. So here's a story that illustrates for me how spousal commitment can symbolically express love of God and neighbor, even when the spark of romantic love is dead and gone. So this is a story. When I was in my early 20s, I attended a weekly Pentecostal prayer meeting with women, all of whom were at least over 50, or at least I thought they were. Maybe they were just 40, but they looked gosh darn old. During one of these meetings, a woman, let's call her Sue, wanted to confess that she had not followed God as closely as she would have liked. So let me tell you what her confession was. About 5 to 10 years prior, I can't remember exactly the time, her husband had had an affair with his secretary. We used to call them secretaries back in the day. Let's call this secretary Sue. And Sue became pregnant. The couple divorced. A short time later, her ex-husband was diagnosed with cancer, and his new wife, was diagnosed with cancer, and Sally was having a very difficult time caring for him and her new baby. So you get the picture. I'm losing my names, but Sue, the secretary, they've married. She's young. She has a young child, and her old husband now has been diagnosed with cancer. So she calls on Sally to help. Sally ended up caring for her ex-husband until he died. At the time that she was talking to us, she was helping care for the child as her grandchild. She wanted God and us to forgive her for not having responded quickly enough when Sue called for help. Needless to say, all of us were blown away by the tremendous love and concern. And I can remember it to this day. This woman really, she had no sense that she had done something remarkable. And in fact, most of us said we didn't think we could do that, and we didn't even know if we should. Still, for me, Sally's relationship to her ex-husband, his new wife, and the baby is an exemplar of what Augustine means by the sacramental signification of spousal commitment. Okay, so much for the apparent tensions or contrast between Kennedy and Augustine's views. Let's talk about some similarities. First of all, both Kennedy and Augustine see marriage as essentially related to the more general good of human friendship. In his second claim, so if you go back on your handout and you can look at that second claim, under the rationale about the court's conception of marriage, remember that Kennedy describes it as a union like no other, where spouses live out their hope of companionship and promise to provide lifelong care. He cites Griswold versus Connecticut's description of marriage as support, and this is a quote, "Marriage is a coming together for better or worse, hopefully enduring and intimate to the degree of being sacred." Kennedy reiterates this point at the end of his argument, and here's what he says. "In forming a marital union, two people become something greater than they once were. As some of the petitioners in this case demonstrated, marriage embodies a love that may even endure past death. It would misunderstand these men and women to say that they disrespect the idea of marriage. Their plea is that they do respect it so deeply that they seek to find its fulfillment for themselves. Their hope is not to be condemned to loneliness, excluded from one of civilization's oldest institutions." Now, philosophers, we distinguish between intrinsic goods. These are things that you desire for their own sake, versus instrumental goods. And these are the things that you desire for the sake of something else. Now, when Kennedy was discussing marriage as a means to exercising and developing autonomy, he's treating it as an instrumental good. Here, when he's discussing it as one of civilization's longest standing remedy for loneliness and a union of enduring companionship and mutual care, he comes awfully close to treating it as an intrinsic good. That is the historically recognized good of friendship. Augustine, on the other hand, is much more explicit. He begins the good of marriage by stating that God initially instituted marriage to serve the great and natural good of friendship. Marriage and sexual intercourse are distinct instrumental goods, both intended for the sake of friendship. Procreative marital intercourse serves the intrinsic good. Now, this is really funny. Good of friendship. Procreating in sex, how does that, in marriage, how does this help? It creates a whole pool of persons that we can now create friendships with. But then he goes on to argue, again, this is 5th century, that this pool is now sufficiently populated, and thus the status of procreation as divinely ordained good for the 5th century Christian marriage is dubitable. And here's the quote. He says, "In the earliest times of the human race, especially to propagate the people of God, through whom the Prince of Savior of all peoples might be both prophesied and be born, the saints were obliged to make use of this good of marriage, namely the procreative good, to be sought not for its own sake, but as a necessary for something else, But now, since the opportunity for spiritual relationship abounds on all sides, and for all peoples entering into a holy and pure association, even they who wish to contract marriage only to have children are to be admonished that they practice the greater good of continence. Don't you love them? So Augustine concludes that bearing and rearing children was an instrumental good of marriage as originally instituted, and it remains the sole purpose of marriage outside the church. Procreation still has a place in Christian marriage, not as a mean for fostering spiritual friendships, but as a means for justifying marital intercourse. Again, I don't have to say you endorse everything he says. And here's what he writes. Continence from all intercourse is certainly better than marital intercourse, which takes place for the sake of begetting children. That's a quote. Marital intercourse for the sake of children doesn't have any fault attached to it, whereas marital intercourse for the purpose of satisfying concupiscence, so I can never pronounce that, is a venial sin. Okay, now look. We might reasonably raise our eyebrows about Augustine's claim that non-procreative marital sex is a sin, and his views on sex generally have legitimately undergone serious critique. Still, I do want to underscore and actually endorse his distinction between a Christian ethics of sex and a Christian ethics of marriage. Too often these are conflated, and they just are different, or so I would say. So I guess that is my other claim. But more to specific to our purposes, Augustine's analysis of procreation as a marital good is simply fascinating, since so often the bearing of children is treated as if it were the sole or preeminent good of both civil and Christian marriages. However, on his view, procreative capacity is neither a necessary nor a sufficient condition for recognizing a union as a marital one that can function well in the service of friendship. For as he wisely notes, and I love this, spouses may well enjoy, quote, a natural companionship long after, quote, their ardor of youth has cooled and their corpse-like bodily members, and this is me now, but he does corpse-like, render the demand and payment of conjugal debts moot. Now that's me. But he's more right than you know. And I was thinking, you know, maybe the sales for Viagra would go down if people. Similarly for Kennedy then. Okay, so this is where they agree, I'm saying. Similarly for Kennedy, while he does cite safeguarding children as a third reason why the court views marriage as a fundamental right. So he does say that. He says, look, one of the functions of marriage is to safeguard children. And he goes on, you know, he argues that this is true even in the case of same-sex couples because often they are raising children. He goes on to say that ability or desire or a promise to procreate is not and has not been a prerequisite for a valid marriage in any state. Therefore, the downplaying of procreation, you know, not saying they get rid of it, but they kind of downplay it as a marital good, is a second significant similarity that I see between Augustine and Kennedy. Okay, that's my aim, you know, so this has been a pretty short talk. My aim with this talk really was just to acquaint you with Justice Kennedy's and St. Augustine's answers to the question, what is marriage good for? My theses primarily have all been interpretive ones, and I trust that I've sufficiently supported them with textual evidence. I've tried to show that Augustine and the majority decision differ in terms of what constitutes the highest human good, and that this probably has significant implications for how they might answer some of the questions that Howard Wass poses, like I showed you. They might both say yes, but they'd say it for different reasons. On the other hand, there are some surprising similarities. Both Kennedy's decision and Augustine's treatise present friendship as an intrinsic good to which marriage is essentially, if only instrumentally, related. And both tend to marginalize the procreative good usually associated with marital unions. My hope in this talk has been to provide a little bit of a richer discursive context for continued discussions about the goods of marriage and who we think can legitimately partake of them. Thank you very much.
Do you have any comments on Augustine's response to same-sex marriages in his context, so outside of this book, perhaps.
Would Augustine have countenanced same-sex marriage? Is that what you're asking
me?
Yeah,
does he have any statements to make against same-sex
marriage? Oh, I'm sure he would.
But that's not part of your radar.
Yeah, no, I'm sure he wouldn't. I think Kennedy's right to acknowledge, and I should be right to acknowledge, right, that in these discussions, what you're talking about really is expanding the notion of marriage, and this is what Kennedy says. He says, look, he owns that the court cases heretofore have, you know, implicitly and explicitly use the term to refer only to opposite sex couples. What he then goes about doing is saying, but if you look at the rationale for treating marriage as a fundamental right, he thinks that rationale holds good for same-sex couples. So, I could find no text, and I'm sure there wouldn't be any text where Augustine would say, I'm for same-sex marriage. If that's the question, maybe that's not, I'm not getting
it. Well, no, I'm saying against same-sex marriage, not for same-sex marriage. And that's, I'm just trying to build up the statement of being in the image of God, male and female, the complementary context of marriage as expressed.
Right, well, in the good of marriage, that doesn't come up, and I'm really restricting, you know, my look, right? In fact, even where he, in the good of marriage, he's countenancing polygamy. So he argues that that polygamy isn't a sin even for early Christians, and there he's citing the scriptures, but saying that the command is for someone in a leadership position just to have one wife. Now, in other texts of Augustine's, it's pretty clear he thinks monogamy is, you know, the way, right? I can't imagine that he even thinks about same-sex marriages. I'm not sure it would come up. I mean, certainly I would assume, as did most of the church fathers, assumed that when they're talking about marriage, they're talking about opposite sex marriage, just like our courts have. The question before us is, you know, whether when we look at the goods of this marriage, we then can say, are those the kinds of goods that then we think other couples, besides just opposite sex couples? And like I said, in my case, what about couples where one of the partners doesn't fit the category of male or female, like an intersex person? So.
Maybe I didn't quite catch it, Terry, but it seemed like you made a distinction between ethics of marriage and ethics of sex.
Yeah.
Which in some ways relates to your comment. Maybe at APU we don't want to talk about sex because we just want to talk about marriage. Could you develop that distinction a little bit for me? I know it's not really the focus of your paper, but...
Okay, this is speculative. And really off the cuff, but I guess here's what I'm thinking. Could I look at a marriage and say, this is a marriage that exhibited marital fidelity? I'd say this. Let's say there's a couple that never sexually cheated on each other. So in some sense, they were sexually faithful. Is that a sufficient condition for saying that they've exhibited marital fidelity towards one another? And I want to say no. So in that case, at least, you know, sexual fidelity is not a sufficient condition for marital fidelity. So what it means to say this is a marriage and it has these kinds of features and we take this to be, you know, a good marriage, it exhibits all the virtues of good friendship and all of those sorts of things. I think there are lots of marriages where the people have maybe not cheated on one another, but they've treated each other like garbage and they're enemies. And I would not say then that they are demonstrating the marital good of friendship in that. Here's the more interesting one. Are there marriages where there's been sexual infidelity, and yet I would still look at that marriage and say, that is a marriage that has demonstrated marital fidelity? And my inclination is to say yes. And actually, I think Augustine is committed to saying yes too. But you got to know Augustine. Whenever someone cheats, it's always the woman for Augustine. You know, they're the ones that can't control their sexual appetites. So that's trickier. So the idea would be that, you know, sexual fidelity and keeping my, you know, sexual fidelity, even if I conduct myself as a responsible sexual agent, may be neither a necessary nor a sufficient condition for saying I've been a good wife. That's stronger. But that's at least one. Does that get at your question? So that's one way in which we want to separate the two.
Therefore, would you say that grace and forgiveness of sin in relationship to your last comment about the fidelity, even though someone may have cheated, comes into play there?
Well, okay, I'm going to get really crazy here, but I mean, let me bracket maybe Christian marriage and just talk about, you know, civil marriage.
Talking in a Christian marriage.
Yeah, so here's an example. I mean, one of the things that's, I think, is just wrong, you know, generally about cheating on, I mean, there's probably a lot of things, right? But I want to bracket whether you disobeyed a biblical command. Let's just talk about a commitment between people. So one of the things that's wrong with cheating is you've broken your promise, right? I mean, if one of the promises that my husband and I make to each other is that we're not going to sleep with somebody else, and he does it or I do it, we've broken a promise. And then usually there's lying and all sorts of other things, right? So there's lots of reasons to think that this is not okay, and that this so that's the way in which it was hard. That's where I'm thinking, gosh, then it seems like, you know, sexual infidelity really just is sort of a breaking of the marital ethic. But then I guess I thought of, well, what about open marriages? Right? So there you haven't broken a promise. You know, so at least you can't cash it out that way. And again, like I said, I'm bracketing then whether I have a promise to God, not just between my husband, right, to conduct myself in a certain way. Now, obviously, when we're looking at virtues, you know, or someone, we're judging that over a period of time. So it's one thing for someone to lie. It's something else for them to become a liar, and for us to say they're a liar. So I think in the same way, it might be the case, right, that someone could, you know, have an affair, but we wouldn't say they're an adulterer, right? I mean, this is funny, and again, these are just speculative ideas, but I do think there's that difference. And by the same token, then in a marriage, I know of marriages, I mean, mine's not one. Hi, Jeff. But I know of marriages, right? Long marriages, 50, 60 years, where there was infidelity. And yeah, there was forgiveness. And honestly, I look at those marriages in my own life now as kind of exemplars of the kind of marital commitment that I hope to live out. So, I mean, I guess that's, again, these things are really fuzzy, but that's the way I'd answer it. These things overlap, but certainly it's not going to be the case that all of my ordinary moral reasoning, all of legal history, and all of that points me in one direction, and then Kennedy says, but this scripture says this, right? Mm-hmm. So the Bible is not going to And kind of rightfully so, maybe, you know, in legal proceedings, as it would for say, myself, right? I mean, there's several things, actually, the scriptures seem to incline me to do that I can see no good rationale for at all. And then I have to say, my kids certainly can't. And then I just have to say, you know, I've committed myself to this book. Now, I'm not a biblical scholar, Kay is. But I think one of the things that's important to note is that the text is rich, and it's been interpreted by lots of people over a really long period of time. And I think that's why it's so important to read people like Augustine on these things, because then I think sometimes we mistakenly think that the church has said one consistent thing about all this stuff, and it just hasn't. I mean, I, for one, think that we as good Christians might want to consider that there could be the thing of marital rape. And that just doesn't seem to have room in Augustine's tradition. So,
I just want some clarification about your statement about the couples in which there was sexual infidelity.
I told you, I was just kind of going off. All right, go on.
Well, I mean, you know, it's tough. Language is so tough, right? Because, it's complex, because if you claim that the couple in which there was sexual infidelity and that one spouse forgave the other, you called that exemplary. Does that, you use that word. Yeah. Exemplars. You said they were exemplars.
You mean Sally, my story about Sally.
Well, no, you later when you were talking in the general rather than a specific.
Oh, no, okay, no, I did. Yeah, okay.
The
people I know, you mean? Oh, okay, yeah, okay. Right. Yes.
So does
there are certain marriages I look at where I know there's been sexual infidelity. And I say, no, that doesn't mean, right, that I want my marriage to copy them in that way, right? That's not my intent, right?
No, yeah. Okay. I'm going to go be unfaithful so I can have
those couples, you know, and we're talking about couples that have been married 50, 60 years.
Yeah, but my point, just to clarify and to work, think it through, is I know you don't mean this, but one could imply by implication that if a person found that their spouse had been sexually unfaithful and they could not continue the marriage, that the sense of betrayal was so profound that would be not exemplary behavior. You see what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah, no, that's what
I
mean.
I
try to illustrate this with a story. I think one can, depending on how you cash, once you sort of separate spousal commitment and paying that conjugal debt, right? Then, and especially in Sally's case, right? She was a good wife to that man and his wife. She was good, exactly, right? And so I guess what I'm suggesting, and that story suggests it, is that spousal commitment can still be in place and enacted amongst divorced people. I think it often does. And that, especially if one of the commitments, and you saw that, is kind of a promise to mutual love and care, right? Now, look, I'm not saying I could pull this off, you know, but you know, remember that's the idea of one of the purposes of marriage is not to die alone, to have someone, and again, Ron, my dad said, because one of my sons isn't married yet, and he says, who's going to wipe your fanny when you're 60 years old? Yeah. so these are the things that spouses do. And I think spouses can do that even when they're no longer married. And I'm not saying they should. I mean, Kay, I know you. I'm not saying they should. Let me with So in philosophy, we distinguish between, you know, obligatory acts and supererogatory acts, okay? Obligatory acts are the things that you're obliged to do. Supererogatory acts are the things that when people do them, we see a saint. If I'm going to have an exemplar, I want it to be a saint. So, and I, like I said, this is not ideal. I've seen this. I have one of my best friends, divorced for a very long time, you know, remarried. She took care of, you know, her ex-husband's mother-in-law was in her house all the time. I think this is lovely.
Marriage is almost a communal act, and you're talking about families and children,
mm-hmm.
but yet the precedent, one of his premises was about autonomy. And it's like, well, on the one hand, you're arguing children and families and community and communal acts and all these connected mm-hmm. wives of wives and things mm-hmm. like that. And then on the other hand, you're basing it on this sense of right of autonomy. And it's like, well, how does that work?
Well, and that's what I tried to explain. So with Mill, you know, often, and we, because we're inheritors of Mill, when we think of autonomy, we think of it very individualistically. There's another notion of autonomy, right? And that is where you see autonomy and each of our individual development is inherently communal and social. And I think that's just true, right? I just think, you know, God love Mill. I just don't think it's possible, really, for me to maximize all of my unique abilities and capacities if I'm Robinson Crusoe on an island somewhere. Right? I think that really that has happened in my life in community with other people. And I mean, in particular, and I can give a shout out, I mean, you know, in my case, my husband. I mean, my husband encouraged me at 30 to go and get my PhD. When I wanted to quit, he was kicking my fanny. So, you know, I think this is just what we do. So part of my argument, too, is that even, because often then, too, autonomy, and like I said, with even in Kant, they distinguish autonomy, self-directed, versus heteronomy, other-directed. But I think it's right, you know, that those things are not, you know, there's this other thing called we-directed, right? And so, in other words, it's not a zero-sum game. I don't always pursue my autonomy at the expense of yours. And so sometimes we do forge these we's. I mean, I think that's, I mean, sometimes those can be unhealthy, right? But in the best case, in a friendship case, right? I mean, Kay's successes really are my successes, right? When she gets a paper published, we've gotten a paper published. And I think this is actually, in fact, the way that it works. And you know, there's been some really good books, a book written just recently by a philosopher named Linda Zagzebski, on what she calls epistemic authority, where she gives a really good argument how, you know, arguing from autonomy could actually then show you that in some cases you actually do need to defer to somebody else's judgment. And I think we do this all the time, right? Once you decide, you know, I always make bad decisions for myself in these kinds of situations, you know? But, you know, Kay doesn't, you know? So, you know, even though I can't see, I'm going to go to her, and I'm not seeing it, but, you know, time has told me that she's going to be better able to sort of, you know, navigate me through this, and I think we do this all the time. And so I don't think that autonomy, you know, if what we mean by autonomy is me becoming what I was designed to be, the unique person, necessarily means I do that by my own bootstraps. In fact, I don't think we do. Did I answer the question?
Early
on. Okay.
Talk too much. But the rest was interesting.
Oh, sorry, I talk too much. That's why I read.
All right, so we probably have time for one more question. And if I don't see a hand go up very quickly, I'm going to ask it. Good. Okay, so here's my question.
Okay.
So sometimes I find the cultural debate about marriage confusing because the terms that different people are using seem so deeply incommensurable to me, right? Mm-hmm. So the civil marriage talk seems so much about social contracts. I think that's okay. That's one thing. And then as a Christian who views marriage as a sacrament, I think, well, I'm not certain why I would be deeply troubled about certain kinds of conclusions someone might come to about a social contract, because I think ultimately I'm gonna think about marriage as a kind of it's gonna be informed by my views about sacramental theology, and I'm not even certain sort of how there would be discourse there, right? So one of the things that was interesting about your talk was there are these points at which Kennedy mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. Augustine come into discourse, but I have this, maybe I'm not, I don't know if you can tell me how if you think, yeah, that's right, or if you think I'm too skeptical or cynical. It seems like the civil discourse about marriage and the, at least the sacramentally oriented Christian discourse about marriage seems so deeply different. They seem irreconcilably incommensurable to me. Do you think that's too cynical or skeptical or not sufficiently open-minded enough, or what do you think?
So, I mean, I do think, like I try to point out, I mean, when Kennedy couches this in notions of individual autonomy and the pursuit of, you know, certain kinds of rights, I think, you know, it's really hard to connect that up then, especially to the sacramental notions of, you know, in the tradition. But when he talks about, when he really talks about, you know, marriage, you know, as this kind of fulfilling this, you know, human desire for friendship and all of that sort of thing, you know, then it seems like we're not talking about contracts. In fact, I didn't quote the thing in full, but the Griswold, Connecticut thing specifically, and this is this notion of marriage as a union like no other, it's not a kind of contracted, you know, there's lots of sort of relationships that we come into for very particular reasons, but, you know, Kennedy and apparently in Griswold in Connecticut are seeing marriage as something, and you know that has this kind of sacredness about it. You know, they use that sort of language. So, I don't think that. I mean, I think they're invoking notions of marriage that are a little bit richer than just kind of a social contract mm-hmm. theory. Now, in terms of how much we can kind of push them together, right now I'm reading, and it's a wonderful book by Guy Witt, on the history of, you know, Christian marriage. And it's changed, right? And part of it, you know, Protestant marriage sort of did assume a kind of more contractual view, right? Well, I'm a Protestant, you know. So, you know, how these things play themselves out, and of course with Augustine you have the city of God and the city of man, but of course these things interweave and stuff like that too. So, I mean, this stuff is really, really messy, yeah. Right? And, you know, so part of it was just, okay, let's just do one thing, right? And sort of say, here's this ruling, how is this guy talking about, you know, can I put them in conversation? You know, here's this one text, and as you know, the gentleman pointed out there, I mean, there's lots of texts of Augustine that I didn't even touch, right? But just to sort of see, you know, when people are talking about marriage, what are they talking about? And you know, are there kind of overlaps or not? And I mean, one of the things, like I said, I mean, Kenny's very explicit that what he's saying, you know, that the ruling that he came up with just extends to civil marriages. But of course, the dissent, and as we all know, I mean, you know, and I was just at a conference, I mean, people are really worried about religious liberty here. And so we can talk about the city of God and the city of man, but I mean, they interlap and they mutually influence each other in really important ways, and they have historically. So I guess that's what I would say.
Well, we are out of time, and we should thank Terry.